Look at the screen above. What's it say? Got good news for you. Who likes good news? Who likes really, really good news? Good, all right, a couple people like good news. Some people are not sure if they like good news. Can I tell you what my good news is? My good news is I saved a bunch of money in my car insurance by switching to Geico. I had to do that one. I had to do my son is on this thing where he's like, Dad, please, enough with the dad jokes. Please, stop it. Because that one where it says, Progressive can't protect you from coming to your parents, but it can protect your home and auto. He's like, Daddy, don't say that. So, but I've really got good news for you. Jesus is alive. And he is good, and he's a great God. I'll tell you a couple of things that happen when you hear good news for the first time. Whenever you hear good news, two things happen, right? And especially if it's super, super good news. It sometimes makes you uncomfortable, right? Sometimes good news makes you super uncomfortable, and I'll tell you why. If I said to Jose right now, Jose, when you open up your email, you'll see a contract to cover all of the public's air conditions in the entire state of Florida. Immediately, what's going to happen with him, be like, whoa, that is awesome. But it would have a sense of being overwhelmed because, I mean, he's got two trucks right now. He's an air-conditioned repair guy. He's got two trucks. He's going to think, man, if I've got to do every Publix in the entire state of Florida, I'm going to need a fleet of trucks to go, you know. If I were to say, hey Reggie, the Andrae leadership just called and they said they want you to be one of their keynote speakers for 10,000 people. And Reggie would be like, the only person who mightn't be too wound up might be Reggie. He'll be like, man, I kind of knew that was going to happen. I kind of expected it. But for the rest of us who would be like, whoa, there's a sense of overwhelmness that happens when you hear good news. And the second thing, it definitely changes your state of mind. It makes you happy overall. It changes your thought process when you hear great news. And so today what I'm about to share, some of the things about, and today it's going to be a really super simple message. I'm going to share with you what I think is really good news about the gospel, because the gospel is good news, right? And the one thing about what news is that news is always past tense. So what Christ already did for you on the cross is already done. It's accomplished, right? That's what makes it good news. It's not good prophecy we're talking about. We're talking good news, something in the past. And so I'm believing God that as you hear these words, something ignites in your heart, a fire and a passion ignites in you, that you begin to experience more of who God is. So here's the first bit of good news. God is in a good mood. God's in a really good mood. Let me read the text. The text in Jeremiah chapter 32 and verse 41 says, I will rejoice over them and faithfully plant them in this land with all my heart and all my soul. The context of that was the children of Israel, they were in captivity in Babylon. And things weren't really going according to plan. And you've ever had something in life where life's not really going according to the schedule that I had. I was supposed to be here. I was supposed to do this. I was supposed to get the house then. I was supposed to be married then. I was supposed to. The plan didn't go according to schedule, right? And so what happens is that we tend to get this thing that happens inside of us when things don't go according to plan. And so I love this text that it says, I will rejoice over them and do them good and faithfully plant them. You know what this text is saying? In the midst of when things are not going so well, God says, I'm going to plant you in this spot so that you could bloom and you could blossom. That's good news. I'm like, man, this is great. And so when things are going bad, it doesn't mean that God's mad. That's a real revelation for some. When things are going wrong in your life, that is not an indication that God is upset. God is in a good mood. Okay, so let me poke some trouble here. Have you ever been around someone that's not in a good mood? That always seems to constantly not be in a good mood? Are you that person that's never... Okay, I'm kidding. If you say, no, I never seem to know anyone that's always in a bad mood, you're probably the one we're thinking of. But whenever someone's in a bad mood, what's our natural reaction? We take steps back. We move away. We don't connect. And you know what happens when you think that God's not in a good mood? You try to take a step back. You pull back away from God. The Bible says that He will never leave you nor forsake you. The Bible says that you are, even better than that, you are seated in Christ in heavenly places. So you're in Him. So it's really hard to be in someone and be in a bad mood. Because God is so good, He is so happy, and He is constantly shining His face upon you. So you might be saying, you know, I've not done too many good things. You don't know what I did yesterday. You don't know what I thought this morning. You don't know the kind of week that I had. So I must have made God angry. The things that I've done must have made God upset. I'm going to tell you right now, there is nothing that you could do to make God angry. There's nothing you could do to upset God. And I could hear to say that God is the perpetual Pollyanna, if you let me use that word, where He is always in a great mood. He's always trying to shine His face upon you. He's always showing Himself to you. So I want you to get the thought out of your mind that your life somehow angered God. Because I tell you today, the best news that you could probably hear is that God's not mad with you. And the reason why is that if you might be saying, well, I don't know. And a lot of this, what I'm talking about, is really upon the platform of you've given your heart to Him. Right? When you give your life to the Lord, when you give your heart to Jesus, life changes. And I would even dare say God's not mad at anyone. Right? He's not mad if you haven't given your life to Him, if you do. But I'm telling you, He wants to invite you into a relationship where your recognition of your heart towards Him completely changes. And so God being in a good mood means that He's not doing anything to hurt you or to harm you. You know, I share this all the time, and if you're kind of your first time here and you've never heard me share this, one of the things that I say is that God's not in the business of giving sickness. If you ever said to yourself, wow, well, I got this sickness because God's trying to teach me a lesson, that can't be right. That can't be right, because if God wanted to teach you a lesson, sickness is not one of the things He'd use. He's too good. He's got a lot of other tools in His toolbox than get sickness to teach you a lesson. And the reality is that if God gives you sickness to teach you a lesson, then you're actually wrong for going to a doctor, because you're trying to stop the teaching of God. So it logically, it doesn't make any sense that God will give you sickness, that God will punish you to teach you a lesson. God came, when Jesus came to the earth, He came to reveal who a good father was. When you look through the Old Testament, you see God did this, God did that. You're like, wow, I'm afraid of that God. That's not what Jesus came to. Do you know what the Old Testament's for? He came to show the severity of the law. He came to show that no one could hold the law. He came to show that this is what happens when you try to come to God in your own righteousness. But when He brought Jesus on the scene, Jesus came, and He came and revealed the beauty and the picture of what our Heavenly Father looks like. And so He's not giving you, he doesn't give you problems to teach you lessons. He's too good for that. He's too good for that. And so I want to encourage you to look to our Father, look to the Lord, because He's really and truly and always in a good mood. Here's this other thing. think my clicker is not working. What's happening there? Number two. Could I get to number two? Maybe you could be my clicker for me. All right. Number two, here's good news. You were dirty. You not now. Here's what this text says in 1 Corinthians. And such were, what does were mean? Were is past tense, correct? And such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus by the Spirit of our God. The subject from that text, that was when Paul was actually talking to the Corinthian church. And Corinthians are Greeks. And and he was talking about all the things that he would do. He says, you know, of some such of were you. You were whoremongers. You were liars, deceitful. And he lists this whole bunch of stuff. And then he says, you're no longer that. Such were some of you. But now you were washed. You were sanctified. You're justified. You know what happens when you fall into sin? You actually forget who you are. That's really what happens. See, what, and if you, like me, the religious context you grew up in is that if you sin, you're a sinner. It doesn't really work like that. You could be, you are righteous, and you forget that you're righteous, and you begin to sin. That's really how it works. Because if I keep telling you how righteous you are, you'll kind of start living the way in which I'm telling you. And I'm not the one telling. Here's what Jesus is saying. Here's what God is saying. You were washed. He said he made you clean. He made you holy. He's washed you whiter than snow. And he says you were sanctified. The word sanctified means set apart. You're set for his use and for his purposes. And it says you were justified in the name of the Lord and by the Spirit of God. If you feel dirty, your emotions are playing tricks on you. If your feelings are telling you, man, I'm not worthy, something's playing tricks on you. Because if you've given your heart to the Lord, if your heart is in the Lord, if you have a recognition of the one God who created you, and you have a belief in him, this scripture applies to you 100%. And so the feeling that you get on the inside, don't let it hinder you, because you're not dirty. You're clean. You're not sanctified. You're sanctified. You're not justified. You know what justified means? Think of it like this way. Justified is just as if I had not sinned. He's looking at you just as if I had never sinned. Justified. Just as if I had. So if he is looking at me like, wow, just like if I'm perfect, fresh out of the womb, why don't I look at me the same way? I'm telling you, that's great news to know how he looks at me. You can't look at you the way you look at you. You have to look at you the way God looks at you. This is why I'm not a huge fan of introspection. I'm not really a huge... How many of you ever introspected and came out excited? Like, whoa! I just looked deep down inside, and boy, I was so happy. I'm saying if you introspect and you don't find anything good, it's because you're looking with the wrong eyes. So I'm a fan of introspection only if you look with the right eyes. It's kind of what I tell people. You should only be allowed to look at news from the eyes of heaven. Anytime you put on a news station, no matter what your favorite news station is, right? And that's why I'm talking about good news. If you look at news with the eyes of earth, with the eyes of man, you'll probably get depressed. But if you look at news with the eyes of heaven, all you see is, oh, I see glory coming. Oh, this is setting up Jesus to come and make a target. This is set up for God to come and explode himself. This is a set up for God to do something great in my time. I'm going to see a renewal. I'm going to see your victory. Oh, this is so good. And if you can't see it the way God sees it, you probably shouldn't look at the news like that, because all it'll do is make you depressed. And unfortunately, if you have the news stations speaking to your heart more than what the Word of God speaks into your heart, you have reason to be depressed. Right? We need the heart of heaven to speak. We need God's voice to speak into our heart more than what anything else. No other voice should have a voice more than the Word of God in our hearts. Because if it does, all it leads is to depression. But then that makes Kayla rich, because then you have to go to her office. So don't make Kayla... No. don't overcrowd her office. It's really easy. It's really easy. Let's go to slide 3. He made you righteous. Oh, that is so good. For if, because of one man's transgressions, that was Adam, one guy, he caused death reigned through that one man. So Adam came, death reigned. The scripture says death reigned through one man. How about this other one man? Right? Much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reigning in life through one man, which is Christ Jesus. Come on. Come on. I was going to drink in that good news, man. One man could cause all these problems, but one man could completely change the game. And when that one man has come, he's come and he's brought for you a gift. He's brought for you the gift. He says the free gift of righteousness. It says much more who will receive the abundance of grace. I felt that. Whoa! I felt something like punch me there when Marisol said abundance. Much more the abundance of grace. Can I tell you something? Grace is not a concept. Grace is not just a thing we talk about from that song, The Amazing Thing, that was how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Grace is actually a person. He is the person, Jesus Christ. So when you've received the abundance of Jesus, what happens? Life happens. And he says, I've given you this grace, this person, Jesus. He is also righteousness. He is love. So when you receive the gift of righteousness, it all changes the game. So if righteousness here is a gift, do you have to work for it? If you have to work for something, does it count as a gift? Right, that sounds like if you have to work for it, it's called a job, right? Whatever you have to work for can't count in the gift category. Here's the thing about a gift. And if you work for it, right, what do you have to do to keep it? You have to continue working for it. What happens if you show up at your job tomorrow and say, you know what, I don't feel like working today? And you do that for 3 days in the state of Florida. No call, no show. 3 days. You're out. Because when you have to work for something, if something is earned, you have to keep working for it and earning it and working for it. But what happens with a gift? A gift is not something you work for. A gift is not something you earn. The gift of righteousness that he's given to you cannot be taken away. So if you've received the gift of righteousness, if you feel, if your emotions trick you to tell you that that gift has gone away, that's really on you. Because no one could take the gift. I don't think there's a scripture that says And the enemy can come and snatch away the gift of righteousness from the believer. Is grace, man, is that in the scripture anyway? I don't think that's there. You can't find that anywhere in the text. Because he's given you the gift of righteousness. And I remember having that discussion. Romans 1 put it this way. Romans 1 opens up by explaining to the believer. He says, "All ye," and he calls them saints. I'm not talking about the football team in Louisiana. He's talking about you. I'm not talking about Mother Teresa only. I'm talking about you. Romans opens up and he says, the ones who believe, the ones who've received this gift of righteousness, they get the badge, they get the star, they get the moniker. They are ones that hold the gift called called righteousness. So if it's your gift, you get to keep it. And the only way you lose the gift is through your unbelief. You have to say, "I don't believe I have this gift anymore." All right, there goes your gift. And I'm not even sure if that's biblical either. But I want to encourage you, you are righteous. You are holy. You know what? Here's what holiness is. If holiness is a thing that you do, and Frank does two holy things, and Mary does one holy thing, Frank is now holier than Mary, or what we call holier than thou. And Frank is like, "Yeah, I do more holy things than Mary anyway." I'm kidding. No, I won't say that. But what righteousness, holiness is a person living inside of you. So the same Holy Spirit in Frank is the same Holy Spirit in Mary is the same Holy Spirit in Lisa. Same one. Frank doesn't get the upgraded version. Frank doesn't get the male version. Lisa doesn't get the female version. And contrary to popular belief, the same Holy Spirit in Marisol is the same one in Thelma. It's not upgraded. All it takes is for you to have an awareness of what's there. I'm hoping today that the good news that I'm describing is that you become aware of what you have. That's what I'm hoping. That you realize, oh my gosh, I have a gun and it's loaded. And I just need to pull the trigger in life. Don't let the enemy trick you. Don't let your mind, don't let anyone deceive you that you are not who God says you are. For one man's transgressions reign through that one man, but you've now received the abundance of grace. And you've been made righteous. So if Jesus is in you and he's given you the gift of righteousness, I'm telling you right now, sin doesn't take away the gift of righteousness. I didn't know that for many years in my Christian experience. I thought every time I sinned, the devil comes and snatches away my righteousness. And I say, "God, I need that gift one more time. Could you hand me that gift one more time?" And it was a daily. So this is how my prayers used to start before I understood this. And if your prayers start like this, I have no problem. You walk your walk with God and learn and grow. But if it's a place because you don't grab your righteousness, your prayers might start like this. "Thank you, Jesus. So, Father, Lord, I come to you today. I want you to forgive me of every sin I've had today. I want you, oh God, to cleanse me and make me righteous and make me whole." He did that 2,000 years ago. He cleansed you 2,000 years ago. I mean, it's okay if you want to have a relationship and ask the Lord, but is it required? No, I don't think it's required, because why? You have the gift. He says, "Come to my throne boldly." And so now I know that every sin that I may have committed is post the cross. It's after the cross. And so I go to the Lord I remember it was the year 2010 when I got this revelation that I could just approach the Lord boldly. Boy, my next time I went to Lord, I was like, oh, Jesus, I love you. Whoosh, the presence of God just showed up. I'm like, wow, this is awesome. And it's been happening for like 11 years. I don't have to work. Okay, Lord, so don't forget, I wasn't so nice to Kayla before, like, you know. And don't forget that, you know, that guy who cut me off on the street there, you know, I said a bad word. It was in my mind. I said a bad word, but it wasn't so good. And the cat walked by and I stepped on the cat, you know. And you know, it wasn't such a good thing. And I go through this laundry list of asking for forgiveness when he's already forgiven you. You are already forgiven. If you're in the gospel, if you're in the kingdom, if you're in the family, you're already forgiven. And so I thank him for this gift of righteousness. Let's go to slide 4. He paid your ransom. 1 Peter 1 and verse 18 says, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver as gold, but with the precious blood like the lamb without spot or blemish. I'm going to give a crude example in a little while, but I think it's important to share said crude example. You, before you came into an understanding of who God was, you were a slave to sin. In the most crudest form of the word, you were the prostitute, sin was your pimp. In the most crudest form of the word, that's what was happening. And I don't know if you know the great Christine Kane. She works with sex trafficking people across the world and tries to rescue people from that life of slavery. And, you know, the terrible world we live in. There are kids that get snatched up, they get abducted, they take them and put them into slavery and sex trafficking slavery. And what groups like Christine Kane do, they actually go in and they try to connect and they send someone in to say, okay, how much for that one? And then they get them and they snatch them away and they steal them and they try to redeem them and get them back. And that's what a lot of groups are doing and try to help those that have been enslaved in that industry. Well, what has to happen is that a ransom has to be paid. And if you look through the scripture, what happens is that when someone is a slave, and there's enough discussion about slavery within our U.S. context, if someone wanted to be a slave, a ransom had to be paid for the slave. And if their ransom had to be paid, when you are bought from that slave owner, you become under the new slave owner after the ransom's been paid. And so I hereby say to you that you were under a slave master, wicked one called sin. And that slave master had you. But the only way that that slave master could release you is that a ransom had to be paid for you. And the slave master sin said, in order for you to be paid for, I'm going to need blood. I'm going to need somebody else to die. That was the only thing that would need to happen. And Jesus said, I'll do it for all of humanity. I'll come, die. I'll shed my very royal blood so that everyone in this room could be bought back. And so we now bought back. Now, here's the cool thing. Usually, when someone's bought back from a slave master, they're being bought from slavery into more slavery. But in your case, you were bought back from your slave master's sin, and now you're bonded to Jesus. Now you are free in Christ. There's neither Jew nor free, bond nor Greek, but we're all free in Christ Jesus. So there is a freedom that exists for you. There is freedom in him. And so you're not a slave anymore. If you feel like a slave, you're not sure who you are. Because everyone who is free needs to understand and operate like they're free. So, but Pastor, you don't understand. I don't feel free. I still feel like I'm owned by the slave master sin. You're not understanding your identity. You're not understanding that royal blood was shed for you. And that royal blood was able to completely bring you out of your slavery and bring you into the what the Bible calls the glorious light. He paid for you. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, He found you. Indeed, I count it as loss because of the surpassing knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. For His sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them rubbish in order that I might gain and be found in Him, not having righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness of God. Easy one. If you feel lost, He's found you. I just want to take it to the last slide to walk this one through as we work it towards the end. Last one, which is 6. He made you alive. You who were dead in your wrongdoings. One translation says trespasses. And the uncircumcision of your flesh. He made you alive together in Him, having forgiven all your wrongdoings. That's a lot of past tense in that text there. A bunch of past tense. And so, the idea with this text is that He's now brought you and He's made you alive. And the reason why I went through all these elements of how great this news is that I wanted you to kind of filter through your mind and ask yourself, wow, that's a lot of things that was, a lot of news that was said. But I'm not sure if I really grasp my identity. I'm not sure if I understand clearly what you're saying. I'm here to give you an invitation this morning. And if you're on the Zoom audience, I'm giving you said invitation as well. Podcast audience, you get this invitation also. That you get to know who this Jesus is. Do me a favor right now and let's all close our eyes. With no one looking around. If you are hearing me today, and you're hearing all this good news, and it you're saying, just like the person who received is like, this is too good to be true. You're saying like, Jose, man, all of Publix that I get, this is just too good. If what you heard today just sounds too good to be true, I have an invitation for you. I have an invitation for you to come into the family of God. I have an invitation for you to reconnect your heart with heaven so that you could recognize and align your heart with your identity in Him. If that person is you, right where you are, I just want you to connect your heart to God. I just want you to connect your heart with heaven. If you feel dirty, if you feel like you're not justified, if you feel unsanctified, if you don't recognize He's in a good mood, if all these things that I'm sharing just feels foreign to you, I want you to turn your heart to heaven. And recognize what Christ has already put inside of you. Recognize the identity that's already in Him. Recognize the greatness of the God that exists inside of you. Because if you only caught a glimpse, it would change you. It would change your thought. It would change your passions. It would change you. Your actions will completely turn around if you got a glimpse of what's inside of you. So Jesus, right now, I pray you show us. You give us a glimpse. You give us a taste of what's inside of us. May we recognize the greatness of our Creator. May we recognize the greatness of the Father who lives inside of us. May we recognize the power and the passion that's in Jesus. Holy Spirit, right now. I thank you. Faith, Abel made a sacrifice. That text does not say by the great work or by blood Abel made a sacrifice. By faith. And so by faith this morning, you have to receive and you have to connect and receive the words of Jesus when He says, you're clean. When He says, you've been made free. When He says, you're alive. When He says, you've been ransomed. When He says, you're not held by the wicked slave master. You have to receive it by faith. So Jesus, now I thank you. We invite our prayer team to come forward. If you have heard the words that we're saying, and it's still very fuzzy in your mind, you're not sure, you're just not quite sure what's happening, I want to invite you to come down for prayer. Let our prayer team pray with you. Thank you, Jesus. If you need prayer for anything at all, I want to invite you down to the altar. You came here to service Resurrection Sunday. The things that feel dead. We sang all those songs. I ran out of that grave, and you're like, I don't feel like running out of no grave. I feel dead. We see dead men come out of that grave. You're like, mm-mm. He's saying, forever He's glorified, the ground began to shake, and you're feeling dead inside. I trust this team members in front of me here that they will pray and they will activate what God has already put inside of you. So come on down if you need prayer for anything at all. Don't be shy, just come on down. So, Father, we bless you. We exalt you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Abundance of grace. The abundance of grace. Yes, the abundance of grace. I'll leave the altar open for a few more minutes and then we'll change the order of our service. So receive the abundance of grace. Glory to God, hallelujah. Glory to God, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Right where you are, connect your heart and connect your passion to Jesus. Yes. I bless you. I worship you. I worship you. Yes, Jesus. We bless you. We worship you, Lord. Worship him this morning. We worship you. We adore 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 you. There is something about that name, Master, Savior, Jesus, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim, kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about
Jesus, if you've never known Jesus, you're missing out. Some of you need to repent. I feel fire in my bones. You may not, it's okay. But some of you have not lived for Jesus. You have the name of being a Christian. This is not a make you feel guilty. But if you've backslid, you haven't lived for Jesus, my friend. I feel the Lord is here asking people, will you die for me? I died for you. Will you give me your life? I've given my life. Romans 6. Go home and read it. Will you give me your life? You can't be a Christian by name. Come on. Give him your life. Give him everything. Sing it, Andrae. Sing it, sing it. Come on. Come on. Dedicate your life to Jesus. If you haven't known him, I promise you, you come here, you're going to know him right away. You're not allowed to say, I can't help it. Because he has helped you. Jesus. Jesus, thank you for every person. Thank you for dying for us. Thank you for rising up from the grave. So we don't have to live in our sin anymore. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Worship you. You're so good to us. up with you. I get to sleep with you. I get to eat with you. I get to do everything together with you. The only thing I don't do with you, Jesus, is the one I choose not to do with you. Because I can help it. Because you're alive. I choose Jesus. I choose you. You're more real to me than life. Jesus, you're more real to me than the air I breathe. If I am a sinner, if I sin, it's because I choose to. Because you're more real to me than sin itself. You're more real to me than the sun that's shining on my face. Jesus, you're my friend. He is your friend. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
I sing to you.
Thank you.
I dance with you. I cry before you here in this place. I'd give my all just to behold you, just to be near you here in this place. Just you and me. Everything so clear. Now I am free. It's just you and me. I don't care who sees it. Don't care who hears it. Oh, how I love this place.
There's such a sweet fragrance. It's going up to the throne room of God the Father. It is your worship. It is your praise. And it smells wonderful. It's the fragrance of worship. You can't be in His presence without this fragrance. But there's such a beautiful fragrance. It's His worship. It's what moves Him. It's what moves the presence of God. It is worship.
Place with you, oh how. Jesus, I am yours. Jesus, I am yours. I am yours. I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours.
Ask Him to touch you where you are. Ask the Lord to touch you. Of Jesus as you want. Ask Him to touch you.
Jesus, I am yours.
Thank you, Lord. You know, this morning when I was spending time, when we were in our prayer, our pre-prayer this morning, the Lord said something to me. He said, do you know, Marisol, because I was just praying, you know, for the service, as we always do. He said to me, you know, Marisol, even for the people to respond to me, it takes for me to draw them in. And that made me think that even that we can't do by ourselves. We can't come to Jesus on our own. That's how limited we are. It's by His Spirit. His Spirit draws us in. So Holy Spirit, right now I just ask that You would draw Your people, that You would draw them in, that they would understand that it's not even them, that it's not up to them to say yes or no. It's really You, Lord. You are tugging on their hearts even right now. I sense that. So Lord, draw Your people in. It's not by might, nor by power, but by Your Spirit, God. Your living Spirit. Thank You, Lord.
We are Your burning.
Thank You, Lord.
Ones.
Thank You, Lord.
We are consumed by You.
Sing, we are Your burning ones.
We are Your burning ones. By You.
You know, you're not your yesterday. You're not your yesterday.
Yes.
Today is a new day. The risen day that brought light. You're not in your darkness of yesterday. Walk in the light of your today. Because Jesus is not yesterday or tomorrow. He's present. He's right now. Connect your heart with Him to a place where you completely abandon yourself. He's to be experienced. The mind tries to get in the way. Allow yourself to experience Him, His goodness, His love. It will change you, I promise. It will change you. It's exactly what you need right now. Thank You, Lord, for what You're doing, Holy Spirit. In the hearts of Your people.
We are Your burning ones.
Taken by the wonder, yes, yes, Jesus.
Here inside your glory,
yes,
we give our lives fully to
yes.
you.
Yes. Yes. Jesus, come upon you right now. May you feel and experience the fire of God right now. Woo! Whoa. Yes, Jesus. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Fuego de Dios. Fuego de Dios. Yes, yes, touch him, God. Are you? Yes. And we cry, holy, burning ones, God. We're burning on fire for you. Fire. Fire, fire. Give a fire, God. Fuego, fuego de Dios. Sha-da-da-da-ba-ka-sa-da-da-da-ba-sa-ta. Fire, 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 fire. Fire in this altar. Fire in this family. Fire in the altar of this family. Fire inside this family. May the fire of God come upon the altar of this family right now in Jesus' name. May the fire of God come upon the Sanders family altar. May the fire of God come upon the Sanders family altar right now in Jesus' name. Fuego, baptize them. Baptize them with fuego. Fire! 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 Yes! Yes! Be like a fire. Let this heart be like a flame. Fill us, Lord, with your desire. May our passion bring you fame. Yes. May this passion bring you fame. The passion of God. When you get on fire for God, everything changes. Get the fuego of God. Fuego de Dios. Fuego. 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 We set our hearts on fire. Yes.
We are consumed. Let's sing it again. We are your burning
fire,
ones.
Fire, fire. Yes. Give him more fire, God. Give him more. Give him more. Give him everything he's asked for. Give him everything he's asked for. I see in front of you, my brother, a blank check from the Lord, and he's saying, just write. It is a blank check, not with dollars and cents, but the very deep and dark, the very deep things of your heart that you've asked the Lord for. He gives you a blank check, and he says, write. He's already signed it with his blood. He's already signed it with his blood. Yeah, 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 yeah. Fire, fire, fire. Yes, yes, come on. Hey, like a flame, so will your desire. Yes, Jesus, may the fire. Whoa, come on, Jesus. I felt that upon you, man. Ooh, glory to God. I felt that. I felt that. Whoa, come on. Whoa, I just saw the power. Whoa. Thank you, Jesus. This is good. This is good. Thank you, Jesus. Fuego. Fire. Thank you, Jesus. May the fire of God come upon him. Fuego de Dios. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, the glory and the fire and the presence of God be upon you. May the glory of God be upon you. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Jesus. Glory and fuego. Fuego de Dios. Yes, yes, yes. Whoa. Yes, Jesus. Yes, yes, fire, fire, fire. Come on. Raise a hallelujah. Whoa.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. Yeah, yeah. Worship him with me. Sing together. I'm gonna sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praise and roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is
rejoicing. We bless you. Just sing a little louder. Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder.
bless you. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yes.